All right. How's everyone doing today? Good? Perfect, perfect. Glad to hear. So, thank you so much for the introduction, Kirsten. Thank you, RCI Science, for having me here today. I'm excited to spend a little time talking about some quantum physics stuff. So, as mentioned, my name is John Donohue. I am a physicist. I spent 10 years in school studying physics, studying a lot about quantum physics, a lot about photonics, a lot about optics. And if you had told 17-year-old me that that's what I was going to do, he would not have believed you. I kind of, you know, I liked science when I was a teenager. I was into it. But, you know, my heroes weren't Einstein or Planck or Bohr or Hawking or any of those guys. My hero was Roger Ebert. And so having the opportunity to, 10 years later, 10, whatever, however old I am now, to whatever time it is now, come back later and kind of merge those two interests is a real treat. So thank you so much for coming out. So what I'd like to first talk about, so we're going to be talking about quantum physics, how it's explained in pop culture, how it comes up in TVs and movies and books and video games. But first, I just say a little bit about what quantum physics is, because you know, it's what we're all here for, really. So quantum physics is just a rule book, just the same way that right, classical physics is a rule book, the same way that Newton's three laws are a rule book. They help us describe, using mathematics, the world around us. What quantum physics does is it describes the world at the sub-microscopic level. This is not, a lot of people kind of talk about quantum physics as if it's some Wild West frontier where anything is possible. No, the fact that we know quantum physics means that we know the rules. We know what happens at the quantum level. Just so happens that some of the rules it obeys is not the same as the rules that we see in the world around us normally. So in the quantum realm, energy is quantized, not continuous. Think about that like you would a dimmer switch. With a dimmer switch, I can go from all the way dark to all the way bright and anywhere in between. So that's a continuous range of energy, a continuous range of brightness. In quantum physics, I can go from dark to bright, but nowhere in between. There's no intermediate level there. So what I mean, that's actually where the word quantum comes from. Things are quantized like ladder steps rather than continuous like a hill. It obeys rules. There are rules down here, rules like the superposition principle and like the Schrodinger equation. However, it doesn't strictly obey rules that we normally think about in the classical world around us. Things like locality, things like if something happens over here, it can't affect what happens over here. It's obeyed, but not strictly in the same sense that we think about in the normal world. Things like determinism. I can roll a dice, and you know, say I'm playing Yahtzee, I put my dice in the cup, I roll them up, I put them down. The result is a six, whether I look at it or not. In quantum physics, that logic doesn't quite hold. Wow. So that's kind of the rule book of quantum physics. And now, if you've kind of been following the news a bit lately, you might think, okay, well, quantum physics, here's this new thing that we're finally able to use. It's kind of a bit of a quantum hype train going on right now. In the last 20 or so years, there's been just an insane amount of investment in quantum technologies, an insane amount of publicity regarding this investment. So Canada, in 2009, invested $50 million in the Institute for Quantum Computing. That's where I'm coming from. The Institute for Quantum Computing started in 2002 based on private investment, which has since been matched by the federal government. Sweden's invested 100 million euros in their Center for Quantum Technology. The UK invested 270 million pounds in their national quantum strategy in 2013. The European Union as a whole invested 1 billion euros in 2017. Canada reinvested $76 million in quantum technologies in 2017. In 2017 as well, China topped everyone by investing $10 million in their national laboratory for quantum sciences, $10 billion US dollars equivalent. Last year, the U.S. announced $1.2 billion in a national quantum strategy, and just a few weeks ago, India announced a $1.12 billion investment in quantum technology. So we are talking big money very recently and big publicity for all of these different investments. Additionally, we're also seeing big news out of kind of large-scale companies regarding their quantum efforts. Microsoft has their Station Q, which has been operating since the late 2000s. And then just in the last couple of years, we've seen a lot of news regarding quantum computing coming out of Google and IBM. You're seeing a whole lot of startups, including just down on Bay Street, the local Toronto startup Xanadu. And all of these have been kind of blocking up the news stream lately. So if I'm looking at this, I might think, so what's this new quantum thing? So okay, we're finally seeing quantum technologies in the news. I guess we finally cracked quantum physics. We're finally doing stuff with quantum physics. Which, no. We've known about quantum physics for a really long time. So quantum physics dates back to the late 1800s, early 1900s. That's when we started realizing that there was something a little wrong with the theory of the universe around us when we applied it to the very, very small scale. It's not that it took 100 years for us to crack it and use it for real technologies. We already use quantum physics for real technologies that you interact with every day. The laser, which was developed and thought about in the 1940s, became kind of used in consumer technologies around the 1960s, 1970s. You can't even imagine what a laser is if you don't have quantum mechanics. I love the laser because, unlike a lot of other technologies, the laser wasn't someone trying to design something. Someone was just playing around with quantum physics equations, came up with something, was like, hey, this might be useful, let's try to build it. But it's all out of playing around with the mathematical description of quantum physics as to why the laser exists. Semiconductors, LEDs, what we use for semiconductor transistors in our phones and our computers, that's all based on understanding quantum theory. That's the only reason it works as well as it does. MRI machines also are based on measuring yourself through a quantum property called spin throughout your whole body. If I don't believe in quantum physics, if I'm not able to use quantum physics to build technologies, no MRI machines. So just because quantum's in the news now does not mean that quantum is new. Quantum's been around for a long time. We're already using it for a lot of stuff. So the kind of phrasing I like to use this is, quantum's already all around us. So quantum all around us. What I don't mean when I say quantum all around us is this. So especially in the last 10 years or so, I've noticed a trend of just throwing the word quantum in front of literally anything to make it sound cool. For the most part, the batteries I can maybe see an argument for, but for the most part, none of these have anything to do with quantum physics whatsoever. The quantum RV, there's nothing going on in there that's making it quantum mechanical. The Yeezy basketball quantum shoes, good-looking shoes. No quantum physics happening there. The quantum sleeper anti-terrorist bed is probably my favorite. Real good. Or the cruise ship, Quantum of the Seas. And of course, I forgot to look up what street it's on, but somewhere in Toronto, you can probably come across the Quantum Coffee Shop. That's my last local reference, I'm sorry. Some of them got the joke, some of them have jokes, like the quantum conditioner, which removes the particles from your hair to unleash its true wave nature. Or UPS Quantum View, which tells you exactly where your package is and gives you no damn idea when it's going to show up. But none of these have really anything to do with quantum physics. This is just kind of quantum buzzwording. What we're doing here is really kind of using quantum as a shortcut. We're using it as a shortcut to say high tech. We're using it as a shortcut to say fancy. We're using it as a shortcut to say you wouldn't understand. Which I hate. So, and this comes up a lot. So we can see in this Onion article, for example, where the sci-fi writer attributes everything mysterious to a certain quantum flux. Doesn't matter what's going on, we need to invent time travel, we need to invent anything like that. We're going to call it the quantum flux, you just put it in this bucket. We can see that a lot in movies we see. Probably the most famous example today is in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, where...
It's quantum entanglement between quantum states of polar molecules in your brains.
Yeah, so I was thinking, do you guys just put the word quantum in front of everything?
Effectively, yes. Was that volume okay? Do we need to turn it up, or? You're good? All right, cool. Ooh. Ah, cool, perfect. That theater lighting, more cinematic. Ooh. Perfect. All right, so yeah, we're just putting the word quantum in front of everything, or once again, using it as a shortcut. So put together a little montage of people using it as shortcuts. In the first couple clips, just take, note of what people are reading in these clips.
People have a lot of misconceptions about California, but none of them are really true.
I don't know.
What's that? Quantum physics?
Yeah.
always been fascinated that light could be a particle and a wave. I was going to study it in college, but then I got interested in biochemistry, and then on a whim, settled on linguistics with a minor in comparative religion.
Wow. How'd you end up in a place like this?
The last girl quit. Can you believe it?
The food court is downstairs. The cookie stand is upstairs. It's not like we're talking quantum physics here.
Like, you should have never had a shot. It doesn't make any sense.
No, trust me, I've known this the whole time.
I understand quantum physics more than I understand how you ended up with CC.
Don't you understand that this is the problem?
All this knowledge about everything, quantum physics, applied mathematics, the infinite capacity of a cell's nucleus, they're all exploding inside my brain, all this knowledge.
Well, first I was going to pop this guy hanging from a streetlight, and then I realized, you know, he's just working out. I mean, how would I feel if somebody come running in the gym busting my ass while I'm on the treadmill? Then I saw this snarling beast guy, and I noticed he had a tissue in his hand. I realized, you know, he's not snarling. He's sneezing. You know, ain't no real threat there. And I saw a little Tiffany. I'm thinking, you know, 8-year-old white girl, middle of the ghetto, a bunch of monsters, this time of night with quantum physics books. She's about to start some saying. She's about 8 years old. Those books are way too advanced for her.
So what are we using the word quantum here for? What is the purpose of it in these clips? In corner grass, it's used to indicate that Nancy is very smart. In mall rats, it's used to indicate that, well, mall layouts are not as complicated as quantum physics, which I dare you to say that to anyone who has to actually do the layout in a mall. In New Girl, we're using it to say that quantum physics is less complicated than Schmidt's relationship. In Lucy, it's compared to whatever the infinite capacity of the nucleus of a cell is. And in Men in Black, it's used to shoot little girls. So in all these cases, we're not actually meant to learn to know anything about quantum physics. It's being used in the same sense that we often hear the word rocket science thrown around. It's used because quantum equals complicated. It's just a shortcut to say, hey, this is complex stuff we're dealing with. So why do we think that? Why is that the percent? Like, how many people, when you hear the word quantum, like, kind of the first word that leaps to mind is complex or complicated or something along those lines? Yeah, like, it's one of the first words that comes to mind for the most part. So why do we have this impression? I think there are three main reasons for this. Let's dive into them a little bit. So reason number one is that it involves math. And this is, I promise, the shortest section. and whenever someone says, oh, it involves math, it automatically seems complex, which even as someone who's spent a lot of time studying physics, whenever someone tries to explain something to me with an equation, I'm like, I'm out. If you can't explain it in words, it doesn't really work. So, and the math does look complicated. You look at Schrodinger's equation, and when you write it out, they always put it in this form, where they're trying to impress you with all these Laplacians and brackets and vector notation and differential equations. If you give that to a third-year physics or math student, yeah, sure, makes sense. But when they kind of like plop this out here, this is there just to look complicated. And don't get me wrong, this is very useful. If I understand this equation, I can use it to understand things like the exact structure of the energy orbitals around an atom, exactly where an electron travels around the nucleus of an atom. I can use this equation is all I need to understand that. That being said, there's a lot of stuff going on there. It's kind of a lot to deal with. But the key lessons are not incredibly not as complex as this equation would suggest. There's two main lessons that come out of kind of studying the Schrodinger equation. One key lesson is that we have discrete energy levels alone. That's that quantization I was talking about earlier, where, for example, I can have either zero particles of light, or one particle of light, or two particles of light, but never like a dimmer switch where I can go with a continuous range of energies. With these atomic orbitals, I can have this orbital, or these orbitals, but nothing in between the two. And that's the lesson that you get out of the Schrodinger equation. The other lesson you get is that this equation is what we call linear, which means that superpositions are allowed. So we'll talk about a superposition in a sec, but the basic idea there is that I can't have anything in between these two possibilities. But I can have something where it's a little bit of each at the same time. It's a little subtle difference between those two statements. All right. Reason number two that people consider it to be complicated is that, yeah, it's a little abstract. Once again, we're talking about the world at the sub-microscopic level. This is not something that we interact with in our day-to-day lives. When I say things like superposition and entanglement, I can't draw an analogy to the world around us because it doesn't exist in the world around us. It is something that is unique to the world that we cannot see with our bare eyes. We often talk about the quantum state, which is also another kind of word that gets thrown around that doesn't really get properly defined. But what the quantum state is, basically, is it's describing a property of an object. The same way that the state of a traffic light can be red, green, or yellow, amber, whatever you want to call it, a quantum state can have similar properties. It can be lower energy, high energy. Or if we have a quantum traffic light, it could potentially have those exact same three colors. But all it is a property of that object. For example, in this case, if you flash back to like grade 11 chemistry, you might remember seeing some of these like, kind of Bohr models of the atom, where the electron travels around in these energy levels around the positively charged nucleus. If the electron is in this inner orbital, we would say the electron is in the state inner orbital. If it's in the outside loop, we'd say it's in the state outside orbital, or higher energy state. The quantum state is not the electron, it is describing a property of the electron.
Well.
All right, so there's other things that we can have states of, so this does not apply just to quantum things like electrons and photons. What else does it apply to? Perhaps most famously, it applies to a certain animal.
What's in the box, Rodinger?
A cat, some poison, and a cesium atom.
The cat, is it alive or dead? Alive or dead?
Answer here, boo.
It's a superposition of both states until you open it and collapse the wave function.
Says you.
There's also a lot of drugs in there.
So, in this clip from Futurama, they pull over Schrodinger. Schrodinger has a cat in a box. The state of the cat can be in one of two possible states. This cat can be alive or the cat can be dead. Schrodinger is honest. He does not know if the cat is alive or dead. However, when Fry opens the box, he discovers very definitively that the cat is in the state alive. So the quantum state of the cat is alive in this particular case. Once again, going back to the onion, we can also think about these quantum slacks. So at a press conference Monday, Hager physicists announced that a successful amendment of successful development of quantum slacks, attractive, wrinkle-free pants that paradoxically behave like both formal and casual wear. With this breakthrough, pants enter a whole new dimension. Conventional notions about the properties and possibilities of slacks have been completely turned on their head. So what they're getting at here is that we can have slacks that exist in one of two possible states. They can be nice, formal slacks that you can, you know, wear to a wedding. Or they could be, you know, those comfy jeans that you just can't bring yourself to throw out. And these slacks exist in a superposition of both possibilities at the same time. So they are both these really comfy jeans and these nice, formal wear pants. What they're missing is that if these pants are in a superposition state, you might be able to go around with that for a very long time and, you know, no one be the wiser. But the second someone asks you, or someone notices, or you're in a situation where it matters which pants you're wearing, they're going to be one or the other. The same way that when we open the box and the cat attacks us, we find the cat in the state alive. The second we walk into the wedding, we have some possibility of being in those super nice formal slacks, and our mom won't say a word. Or we're going to be showing up in our old dusty jeans, and our mom is going to start sending some passive-aggressive texts. Because it existed in a quantum superposition, the outcome we get is going to be completely probabilistic. There's no way to know in advance what situation I'm going to find myself in. But once I'm measured, it's going to not be both at the same time. It's going to be one or the other. We can kind of see this effect in a passage from Catch-22. They don't actually use the word quantum physics here, but I like it in that it evokes the same concept. So in this case, they have a soldier, what they call the soldier in white. He's wrapped in bandages. From head to toe, he's completely encased, being supervised by these two nurses, and next to our protagonist, Yosa Ryan. So, at a certain point, Nurse Kramer decides to inspect what's going on with the soldier in white. Nurse Kramer read the thermometer and discovered that he was dead. Now that Yosa Ryan looked back, it seemed that Nurse Kramer, rather than the talkative Texan, had murdered the soldier in white. If she had not read the thermometer and reported what she had found, the soldier in white might still be lying there alive exactly as he had been lying there all along, encased from head to toe in plastic and gauze. Plaster and gauze. Lying there that way might not have been much of a life, but it was all the life he had, and the decision to terminate it, Yosef Ryan felt, should hardly have been Nurse Kramer's. According to Yosef Ryan, the soldier in white, he's completely encased in plastic. We have no way of knowing if he's alive or dead. So in Yosef Ryan's mind, he exists in a superposition state of being both alive and dead. The second that Nurse Kramer reads the thermometer, discovers that the soldier in white has passed, she has made a measurement, she has collapsed the state of the soldier in white to the state dead in this case. And Yosef Ryan is now blaming Nurse Kramer for the death of the soldier in white. Obviously, that's not how the soldier in white works, but if Nurse Kramer had made the decision to check an electron, see if it's in the inner or outer orbital, when she decides to make that measurement, when she decides to stick a probe up to that electron to determine what energy it has, that's going to cause the electron to have to make a decision. It was comfortably existing at superposition. Once we decide to make a measurement, or once something in the universe, doesn't have to be a conscious being, once something in the universe gets close to it, close enough to measure what state it's in, it has to make a decision. We can see this idea of, so the one thing I don't love about that is the idea of conscious observers. There's no idea of consciousness when we talk about quantum physics. There's no idea of that. It doesn't matter if I'm a conscious observer or if I'm a nearby other electron that happens to pick up the electric field or anything like that. Anything that's going to disturb the state is going to cause it to either collapse or form this large, large entangled state, depending on if you believe in collapse theory or many worlds theory, which is a discussion for afterwards. But we can see this idea of conscious measurement coming up in this episode of Doctor Who, which I will let Carey Mulligan take it away.
What do you mean, angels? You mean those statue things?
Creatures from another world.
But they're just statues.
Only when you see them.
What does that mean?
Lonely assassin things, they used to be called. No one quite knows where they came from, but they're as old as the universe, or very nearly. And they have survived this long because they have the most perfect defense system ever evolved. They are quantum locked. They don't exist when they're being observed. The moment they are seen by any other living creature, they freeze into rock. No choice, it's a fact of their biology. In the sight of any living thing, they literally turn to stone. And you can't kill a stone.
So,
here we have the weeping angels. The weeping angels are quantum locked. When you observe them, you're measuring them, they are frozen in space. When they are unobserved or unperturbed, when nothing is there to observe them, they are allowed to move or evolve. This actually has a very, very strong connection to a real phenomenon in quantum physics, which we call the watchdog effect, very related to something called the quantum Zeno effect for any philosophers out there. So, what the watchdog effect basically does is we say we have an atom, and it has two electrons circling around it. Now, what I want to do is I want to bring one of these electrons to the, I want to give it energy. I want to provide it energy so that it goes from the low energy state to the high energy state. So far, okay? Yeah? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to send laser light, and I'm going to hit the electron with some laser light. And it's going to absorb some of those photons, it's going to give it the energy it needs to move to the higher energy state. So zap it, electron goes to higher energy state. Now, to measure which state the photon's in, what I'm going to do is I'm going to send more laser light at the electron. So I want to know if it's in the high energy or low energy state. I send in more laser light. If it's in the high energy state, everything's going to glow really bright. If it's in the low energy state, I'm going to see nothing. That's actually how they do it in the lab. So one laser to make it go to the higher state, and another laser to read what state it's in. I'm not an atomic physicist. Any atomic physicists here? Cool, we're all on the same page. So I'm not going to think about this in terms of atoms. Let's think about it in terms of something we're all familiar with, which is sad pizza. So we have this frozen piece of inedible pizza. We're going to put it in the microwave, and eventually it's going to evolve into slightly more edible pizza. So what we're basically going to do is we're going to put it in the microwave. That's the first laser. That's what's going to zap it to heat it up. And then we're going to be impatient because there's no way we're making this if we're patient people. So we're going to keep opening the microwave to see how the pizza's doing. So that's the equivalent of this second thing. So normally, I leave this pizza in there for 60 seconds, and it goes from this mess to this mess. perfectly. However, we all know that, you know, if you've ever had a kid open the oven to look at cookies in the oven, if you keep opening it, it doesn't work. It just doesn't work. Same idea here. In quantum physics, the more I check what state it's in, I prevent it from evolving to the state that I want it to be. I prevent it from going from the lower energy to the higher energy. I prevent it from going to frozen mess to hot mess. And we can actually make a little plot like this, which shows that the number of times I check it, so if I only check it once at the very end, I have a 100% chance of my pizza being done. If I check it twice, so once in the middle and once at the end, I only have an 80% chance of my pizza being done. If I check it 15 times, if I press that button every 3 seconds, then I really only have a 20% chance of my pizza being done at the very end. This is a consequence of the fact that there is no intermediate state of half goopy pizza. I either have a completely frozen mess or this perfectly done mess. And the overall takeaway message here is that the more I look at a quantum state, I can freeze it from evolving, and a watched quantum pot never boils. Whew. So that's why people think it's quantum complicated, because in order to explain this principle, I had to go through about 4 different metaphors. So why else do people think quantum is complicated? And yeah, so I couldn't just explain that with electrons and, you know, give a real picture. I had to, you know, involve the pizza. I had to bring up the pot metaphor because, you know, that's just how we work. We work through idioms. Reason number 3 is just we can't hold it in our hands. It's something that occurs on the very, very small scale, even below what like a microscope can see. That's where the magic happens. And we can't just like, you know, unless we're playing with the math or playing with the physical systems, we just can't hold on to it. And also, you know, we don't need quantum physics to understand most of the world around us. There's something that Bohr called the correspondence principle, which states that, well, classical physics isn't wrong. Like the physics we had before quantum physics, it's not wrong. It just doesn't work for the small scale. So quantum physics better not matter at the large scale, because we've been using classical physics to do things like send rockets to the moon and understand electrodynamics and do all this kind of crazy stuff. So, I mean, there's no way it's just wrong. So I'm going to play one more little clip. Focus on the words, but also focus on how good the beat is.
Physics could never show you the world I was in when I was 10. Back when 9 ounces had got you 10. And 9 times out of 10, don't pay attention. And when there's tension in the air, now I'm with extension.
Secondly, yeah, so the one word that Kendrick started there with was quantum physics could never show you the world I was in, because we don't need quantum physics to describe the world that Kendrick Lamar is in. If I wanted to pull a full quantum picture of Kendrick Lamar's world, and I wanted to paint that, that would take a huge amount of mathematics, and it just wouldn't matter, because we already have classical physics, we already have socioeconomics, we have all that kind of stuff to describe it. We don't need quantum physics. That's the idea of the correspondence principle. Quantum physics must correspond with what already works at the large scale, which makes sense. You know, it has to work with other experiments, and everything has to play nicely together. But because we can't hold it on our hands, like quantum physics is what I call born on the blackboard. It was not necessarily something like classical physics where someone threw a ball in the air and was like, oh, it fell down. How do we describe that? It was something that came up because people were observing something, they were having trouble explaining it mathematically, so they came up with a new type of math to describe it. So if you have to credit one person, you would credit Max Planck, and the discovery, the kind of weird thing that tipped off people about quantum physics was light bulbs and toasters. When you heat them up, they glow. How do we describe what colors they glow? Using the theory of radiation that they had at the time, it wasn't quite matching up. By treating light as being emitted as these individual chunks called photons instead of as this continuous stream of wave energy, they were able to show that it matched up. Originally, I thought it was a mathematical trick. Turned out to have much deeper implications than that. Funny enough, this is the first thing that comes up when you Google like Max Planck's result, the solution to the ultraviolet catastrophe, and it is also the exact same image shown on the blackboard in the middle of Lawrence Fishburne's talk in Ant-Man and the Wasp, which, yeah, there's a lot going on that slide. I don't know what's going on here exactly, but everything else seems like spectroscopy stuff. So it all started out with the nature of light. So we came up with the fact that light is emitted in these discrete bundles, which we call photons. I can have 0 photons, 1 photon, 2 photon, 3 photon. I can never have 1.5 photons or pi photons. But we already know that light interferes like it's a wave. It's a wave of electromagnetic energy. We can design interferometers that take two beams of light and they interfere the same way that waves interfere. So in some cases it behaves like a particle, in some cases it behaves like a wave. We call this wave-particle duality. Mm-hmm. So the quantum nature of light is going to come up in the next clip, which is from one of the best movies ever made of all time, Plan 9 from Outer Space. So here they're going to be talking about the solarinite bomb. So if you haven't seen Plan 9 from Outer Space, in this film, aliens come from space and start raising the dead. As zombies who start attacking people on the ground. And now we're near the end of the film. They're explaining why they had to do this. Why did they have to come to Earth and, you know, make things difficult for the United States of America? And it has to do because they're worried about the United States developing this solarinite bomb. I'll let Eros describe exactly how the solarinite bomb works.
The solarinite is a way to explode the actual particles of sunlight. But that's impossible. Even now, your scientists are working on a way to harness the sun's rays. The rays of sunlight are minute particles. Is it so far from your imagination they cannot do as I have suggested? Why, a particle of sunlight can't even be seen or measured. Can you see or measure an atom? Yet you can explode one. A ray of sunlight is made up of many atoms. So what if we do develop this solarinite bomb? We'd be even a stronger nation than now.
Stronger.
You see? You see? Your stupid minds! Stupid! Stupid!
So this guy, Eros, is our alien. He's named Eros after the Greek god of love because, look at him. He says a lot in that 1 minute there. So the rays of sunlight are minute particles. Let's be generous to Eros here. So we do know that light is made up of photons, which behave like particles. In the terms of minute, why we don't actually see particles, why we don't, like, you know, look around and see light being like emitted like tennis balls, well, they're small. They are minute. So if I look at a standard 60-watt light bulb, it emits something like 20 million trillion photons per second. If I lose one or two photons, I'm not going to notice it with my eyes. We're just not sensitive to that level. So you know what? I'm going to give Eros a win here. I'm going to give Eros a win here. Rays of sunlight made of minute particles. That's one way to phrase it. The ray of sunlight is made out of many atoms. Well, atoms have mass, and photons notoriously do not. Why a particle of sunlight can't even be seen or measured. So, which again, I'll generously interpret as why a photon cannot be seen or measured. Even in the 50s, when this movie was made, we had things that could actually detect the presence of a single photon of light. We've made a lot of progress since. They're much better and more efficient now, but they existed then. We had the technology, and really all we have is kind of fancier versions of the same technology now. So, could we measure a single photon now? Easy. Could we measure it then? With some difficulty, but yes. So, and he's, you know, a super advanced alien, so we should really have some photon detectors with him. And finally, he says, your stupid mind's stupid, stupid, which he is absolutely correct about. What he also mentions is exploding the actual particles of sunlight. Once again, I'm going to be really generous to Eros here. And I'm going to say what he meant by explode was to split a particle of sunlight, and by particle of sunlight, a photon. He wanted to split photons up. Turns out, this is a thing we can do. We can split a photon in half. Just because we cannot have half a photon does not mean we cannot split a photon in half. And this is actually what I worked on a lot during my research time. So we do this using a process called parametric down conversion. This is a non-linear optical process. So if anyone remember Donna Strickland's Nobel win from 2018 now? It's already been 2 years. That was work in the field of non-linear optics. That is where light can convert from one color, one energy, to another using these special kinds of crystals. This process of splitting photons in two uses the exact same idea. So we start off with a strong laser pulsar. If you want to think about it as a single photon, it's going to enter this nonlinear crystal. Let's say that this strong laser pulse is a blue color. So blue light is short wavelength, very, very high energy. That's why we worry about UV rays, because it's very, very high energy radiation. So the blue light's going to enter the nonlinear crystal, and because of the nonlinear properties of the crystal, there's a chance that that blue photon's actually going to split in two. This is fine, because it obeys the laws of conservation of energy. The blue photon splits into two red photons. The energy of those two red photons adds up to the energy of the blue photon. We go from one to two photons, but that's fine. There's still energy is conserved. Everything is fine with this. Now, then, this is no chain reaction. There's no energy conversion here. We have conservation of energy at all steps throughout this process, so it's not a bomb. But what we end up with is a pair of entangled photons. So as I mentioned, these photons have to add up to the energy of the blue photon. We don't know which energy each individually has. So the energy of one photon is entangled with the other. If I measure this energy, I know this energy. A lot more details beyond that, but let's talk a bit about what we mean by entanglement. So entanglement can really be defined very simply as not separable. So if I have a separable state, that means that I can think about photon one, which I'm going to call this blue circle, and I can think about photon two as this red circle, and I don't need to think about them with respect to each other at all. Photon one is completely defined independent of photon two. They're completely separable. Entangled states, on the other hand, are where I can't think about this photon without also thinking about this photon. This photon doesn't exist or isn't well defined without also describing its partner. Yeah? I mean, yeah, they kind of exist together. They're one with each other. They form a more complete whole. This is like, yeah, so there's a clear line of separation here. You can't describe one with the other if they're entangled. So this is like pretty romantic, I think. Like, I mean, I can't think about one photon without describing the other. So this is an image from NASA where we have these two entangled particles and they're just, you know, deeply, deeply in love with each other. We can also think about Jim Jarmusch's film, Only Lovers Left Alive. Good movie. Involves two vampires played by Tom Hiddleston and Tilda Swinton, who have been together for, you know, centuries, so much that they are entangled with each other. They feel each other's moods. It's very poetic. I do kind of like it. And if you were in Vegas a few years ago, you could try getting married through quantum entanglement. They will take one of those crystals, shine laser light through it, and shed you and your partner both with entangled photons to strengthen your bond. This is an art project. They weren't making money off it, so I'm not actually mad at them, but still. All right, so this is one, like the romantic angle of entanglement is one thing, but when we start talking about entanglement for high tech, there is one thing that keeps coming up that just gets me every time. So I'm gonna let Mass Effect 2 go through what their definition of entanglement is.
What's this area of the ship?
This is the FTL communications room. This allows lag-free communication even when you operate off the comm grid.
I've never heard of a quantum entanglement communicator. How does it work?
Essentially, two subatomic particles are created in an entangled state. One is installed here, and the other in the elusive man's office. When one particle occupies a given quantum state, its entangled partner will always enter the opposite state, no matter the distance between them. If we alter the state of our particle, that alters the state of the elusive man's. This allows us to send data in the form of quantum bits.
Cool. So, okay, let's break that down a bit because, no offense to the computer, but some images would help. So what they're basically doing is we have our hero, Shepard, and this guy who, surprise, is the bad guy, who'da thunk, just looks so inviting and friendly, doesn't he? So what they're going to do is, well, Shepard, while he's with the elusive man, they're going to create a whole bunch of entangled particles. So they're going to take a whole bunch of atoms, they're going to entangle them together. So, you know, maybe their state, if they're in the inner or outer orbital, something like that, those properties become entangled. So they're going to do that locally. And now Shepard, he's going to go gallivanting around the galaxy, many, many light years away, but he's going into contact with this guy, who once again, surprise, is the bad guy. And he's going to want to communicate with him quickly. He doesn't want to wait years for his communication to go from one to the other. So what he's going to do, they're going to run over here, and now to send a message to the elusive man, what he's going to do is he's going to make a little change on his particle. He's going to flip it. He's going to send in some laser light. He's going to do something to change the state of his particle. And because they're entangled, or so they claim, that's going to instantaneously cause a change on the elusive man's particle. They can use that to send information from one person to the other by measuring what state their electrons are in. The important thing about entanglement is that it does not work like that. There is no instantaneous change that suddenly goes from one party to the other. That's just not allowed. So the first rule of entanglement club is that entanglement does not allow information to travel faster than the speed of light. We can think about entanglement as being like a correlation. If I have a shoe, and I give you the other shoe, but I put it in a box so that I don't know which shoe I gave you, but I want to tell you the game from the same set. And now I go to, you know, Alpha Centauri. I go on Shepard's ship and go all the way around the world. And now I open my shoe box, and I find that I have the right shoe. Do I know what shoe you have? Yeah. Now then, say I take my shoe, and because I, you know, grew up in a shoemaking family, I quickly undismantle it and remake it into a left shoe. Does that change what shoe you have? No. The same kind of concept applies to entanglement. Just because I change something over here doesn't change anything over there. All entanglement is that kind of correlation plus a little ingredient that we call coherence, which is what allows superposition to be different than a random chance. It's an important difference, but it does not allow you to do this kind of thing. So why do people care about entanglement? What does it actually allow you to do? Well, let's set up a scenario. So let's say Alice and Bob are playing a game. Yeah? So Alice and Bob want to play a little game with each other. I tried a long time to come up with like a really good analogy here, and this is the best I can do. I'm so sorry. So Alice and Bob are playing a game, and there's a big wall between them. They can't communicate to each other. And just for, you know, just for completeness' sake, let's say Alice is on Uranus and Bob is on Mars. They're really far from each other. There's a giant wall. They can't talk to each other at all. And with them on these distant planets are two agents. And those agents are going to ask them a very important question. Question one or question two. One of these two questions. They don't know which one they're going to get asked in advance. And Alice and Bob are going to respond with a very, very important set of answers. Yes or no. And what they want is to fill out this table. So if they both get asked question one, doesn't matter if they both say yes or both say no, but they should both agree with each other. So if they both get asked question one, they should either both say yes or both say no. If they get asked opposite questions, they should always also agree with each other. Question one, question two, they better both say yes or both say no. However, if they both get asked question two, they should disagree with each other. One should say yes, the other should say no, or vice versa. So you think about, okay, how would I do this game? You can establish a strategy before you go to your distant planets. You can do whatever you want that way. And that's fine. That's allowed. And what we'll see is that, okay, no matter what strategy I come up, you can stare at it, you can hit your head about it as much as you want. You cannot do better than 75% chance of winning. Effectively, the best strategy is equivalent to just always saying that you'll agree and just, you know, agreeing to lose the cases where you both get asked question two. That's the best strategy there is. However, if you're allowed to share a quantum entangled pairs beforehand, then by doing different measurements on your quantum pairs and using that as your shared strategy, you can win 85.4% of the time. Pretty cool, huh? Yeah, no, it sounds like garbage. Like, why do we care about this? But here's the thing. If I am able to win this game with 85.4% probability, that means that my particles were genuinely entangled. There is no way that I can get that kind of probability without having a quantum entangled pair with my partner. As you might have heard from, as you saw from that measurement talk earlier, when I measure a quantum state, I disturb the quantum state. And in fact, I break entanglement. So if I'm able to complete this game and able to show that I have an 85.4% chance of winning, then I can say with certainty that no one's been observing my quantum states in the middle. So this is one way that we can say, ensure that our communication is secure. Because if someone was trying to eavesdrop or hack into our line, we would at best be able to have 75% probability of winning this game. We can also use it to verify that our state is actually entangled, do all these kind of things. This is what we call a Bell test. If it might have come up before, and like one of the neat things people are trying to do now is do this over as long a distance as humanly possible, both for like kind of security and tech reasons, and also just to validate that quantum mechanics actually works over these incredibly long distances. So this sometimes gets called spooky action at a distance, which is also the name of a great Lotus Plaza album. I don't like the word action because, once again, when I measure my particle, nothing actually changes on the other side. But it is more correlated with that other particle than should be allowed using classical physics. So I like to call them spooky correlations at a distance. And you know, the word spooky here, you know, it's not that spooky. It's all in the math. But you know, even physicists really like to hype up the spookiness angle, such as this ghost imaging paper. So this is from an academic paper. And people are really hyping up the spooky nature of the entangled images that they're able to get with it. Generally, I think, you know, the ghosts are fun. I'm not anti-ghosts. But when we use terms like spooky action at a distance, it lends it a kind of a mystical flavor. And this is the one part where I find that, like, when you investigate what's going on in pop culture with quantum physics, this is the one part where it starts getting a little dangerous. What we call quantum mysticism. Here's a couple more clips about that.
We'll return without knocking the guy's robe back.
Hello, great Mormons.
Actually, we're stubborn Presbyterians, and we come to see my daughter.
Why do you get to choose?
What?
Why do you get to choose? I mean, why don't I get to choose? Why doesn't he get to choose?
Well, actually, nobody on this planet ever really chooses each other. I mean, it's all a question of quantum physics, molecular attraction, and time. By their laws, we don't understand that bring us together and tear us apart. I mean, it's like pheromones. You get three of us together, they can't do it. You get 300 million of them, they can build a cathedral. Well, where are you going?
After 12 years in the minor leagues, I don't try out. Besides, I don't believe in quantum physics when it comes to matters of the heart.
All right, so what's going on in Bull Durham there? Well, Susan Sarandon's character is basically saying, well, because of quantum physics, we don't have free will. Everything at the quantum level is probabilistic. We don't get to choose whether our slacks are jeans or dress pants. It's just a complete random chance. So we ain't choosing anything. No one really chooses anything. Some people actually make this into like a mantra for living. Which this one's actually kind of harmless. Just like, okay, one way to understand the universe potentially. Go nuts. Where it gets weird is when you start taking that to the next level. So one idea is that, well, quantum physics, everything's random. And the act of observing things changes them. Whatever observation actually means. So if we go to something like, what the bleep do we know, they take that as meaning that we create our own quantum reality. Whenever we observe, if we observe in the right way, if we observe nature in the right way, we can make it conform to our will, which is driven as some kind of self-help cult, basically. And this is where it starts getting dangerous. Also, this is the worst movie I've ever seen in my entire life, if you've ever actually seen it. It is. Cinema is dead, is what I'm saying. So this kind of stuff is where it starts getting dangerous, and where it starts getting predatory is when we start talking about things like the NeuroConnect. So let's hear more about the NeuroConnect. So this was on an episode of Dragon's Den. So the Canadian Dragon's Den, not the American Shark Tank. And let's see what happened to NeuroConnect. It is not called science. It is called hucksterism. So they all got taken for a ride. They bought that. They bought, like, I think four of the five joined forces and kind of kicked the fifth one out who really wanted in. So all five of them were just into it. And that ended up made the hucksters a lot of money. That being said, there was absolutely nothing quantum physical or even scientific in any sense of the word going on in that video. What's going on, basically, is actually, can I get a volunteer? Yeah? Come on up. All right, so I'm going to show you my quantum-enabled device, which is going to help you improve your balance. Are you ready? Yeah. Sorry, what's your name?
Ben?
Hi, John. Nice to meet you. Thanks. All right, big hand for Ben. Big hand for Ben. So, Ben, what I want you to do is first we're going to test your balance without the quantum device.
Okay.
So what we're going to do, I'm going to ask you to put your 2 feet in front of each other like this and stand with your arms out. All right, you feeling okay? Feel like you got okay balance right now?
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to touch your arm, and I'm going to try to see if I can unbalance you. Are you ready?
Okay.
Yeah?
Okay.
Not very hard. Let's try it one more time.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah? All right. Don't have a whole ton of balance. Okay, let's try to fix it. Let's try to fix it. So what I have here is a pop socket, but a very special pop socket. I have put this in the path of a beam of entangled photons. I actually did, just 'cause. What I'm gonna ask you to do is I'm gonna ask you to put this pop socket in your pocket, and what's gonna happen is it's gonna send those entangled photons that it's connected through your nervous system, which are going to rebalance you and allow you to feel much more comfortable and much more balanced. It's gonna improve your golf swing, it's gonna improve your gym routine, it's gonna improve everything. All right, are you ready? Let's try this test again now that you have the pop socket on you. All right, stable? Whoa, yeah. I can't put you down anymore. You feel that? Yeah. So can you tell what I did there?
I think you pull my hand to the other side.
Exactly. So that's all they're doing there. You can see it very clearly in some of their other videos. And one, oh no, that's yours. All right, thank you again for coming up.
Thank you.
So yeah, in the first case, without the clip, they're going to push away from your center of mass. They make it very easy to push you over. In the second case, they're going to push towards your center of mass where you have a much better capability of staying stable. That's all they're doing. That's the whole grift. And that's how they're selling these NeuroConnect things. So be very careful about people putting the word quantum in front of everything is basically the thing there. There is real quantum technology. There is, like I said, the laser and the MRI are real quantum technologies. Anything that you can buy at As Seen on TV is not a real quantum technology. Until I see otherwise, that's a blanket statement. So what is in the quantum future, really? So while I am coming at you from the Institute for Quantum Computing, so I should probably talk about quantum computing a little bit. However, as is part of my job, I talk about quantum computing a lot. So to finish off this talk, I'm going to let other people talk about quantum computing for a bit. And then we'll see how they do.
They hacked your firewall in 10 seconds. Okay, even a supercomputer with a brute force attack will take 20 years to do. The signal pattern is learning. It's evolving on its own. And you need to move past Fourier transfers and start considering quantum mechanics.
There is nothing on Earth that complex.
What about an organism? A living organism? Maybe some kind of DNA-based computer? And I know that sounds crazy.
That's enough.
So in this clip from the 2007 Michael Bay film, Michael Bay piece of cinema called Transformers, at this point, these are all the characters that we forgot were in Transformers, basically. There's like a cast of like 17,000 people in this movie, and we basically only remember Shia LaBeouf. So what they're saying here is that the Transformers might be using quantum computing in order to get their edge. So what's right about this is, well, yeah, the concept of Fourier transforms are important for understanding quantum systems. They're how we get from like one way of measuring it to the superposition way of measuring systems. And it does make some unscalable problems possible. Problems that we might have in computer science where, you know, even supercomputers would have a lot of trouble solving them can be done in a much more more scalable or more efficient way on a quantum computing device, a device that uses these quantum states to process information. There's some debate in the field whether or not it's actually useful for machine learning and pattern recognition types of problems. That's a huge debate in the field right now, actually. If you can publish something on quantum machine learning, you're in business for a while. I don't know what a Fourier transfer is, but I'm going to assume that's a Fourier transform. And once again, there's like really nothing to do with quantum consciousness. But you know, all things considered, I'm going to give them a C. Transformers gets a C for quantum computing. Good for them. So while I was getting ready for this talk, the best thing in the world popped up in my news feed, and that was the title of last week's episode of MacGyver. So it turns out, first off, there's a remake of MacGyver. I didn't know that. And the episode that they aired last week was called Red Cell plus Quantum plus Cold equals plus Committed. So, of course, for the first time in many years, I watched an episode of MacGyver. And here's what happened on that episode of MacGyver.
Quantum recursive chip. QRC quirk. So what is the next generation in microprocessors?
This is the holy grail, supercomputers. If computers are cars, then this chip is the difference between a Model T and a Formula One racer.
Right, so...
Let's stop. Second problem, the quantum chip has to be stored at an extremely cold temperature, 230 degrees Kelvin.
230, that sounds very hot.
Converted to Fahrenheit, that's 45 degrees below zero.
What happens if the chip warms up?
It disintegrates.
So, first off, this is the first time I've actually said the word MacGyver out loud, and I just want to say it out loud for the rest of my life.
It's so sad. As a group, can we all just say MacGyver out loud? One, two, three, MacGyver. Oh, it feels so good. It's just got that great mouthfeel. It's great. So what's going on here is they are trying to steal the quantum chip, the quirk chip, from the lab. What do they get right? What do they get wrong? Well, they're right. Like, same as the Transformers, it's a new paradigm of computation. It's a new era of computer science. It's a new way to solve different problems. Important thing here that they say is that, you know, it's the Ferrari compared to the Model T. There is no reason to think that we are actually going to have quantum computers that are going to replace our desktops. Quantum computers are very, very good at solving very, very specific problems like factoring large numbers and like certain graph theory problems that like end up mapping into useful problems. They are not going to be any better at like running Microsoft Word or searching the internet. They're not good at those kind of problems. They're no better than a regular computer at solving those kind of problems. They're very useful for scientists for, say, simulating other quantum systems and doing these kind of abstract mathematical problems. And they will be useful in terms of how we develop new technologies beyond that, in terms of, you know, if you ever think about what a supercomputer does, a quantum computer will be similar to that, solving very specific problems. Won't be something we just plug into our desktop. And they are also right that these quantum circuits need to be cold. However, their sense of cold is very different than what a scientist's sense of cold is. So they say that these chips need to be kept at 230 Kelvin. So Kelvin is a temperature scale where zero is absolute zero, and then room temperature is something like 298 Kelvin. So 230 Kelvin, that's about negative 43 degrees Celsius. Based on the chip that they're looking at, it's probably based on a superconducting circuit. That is a circuit where we put aluminum on silicon, we cool it down to the temperature where aluminum becomes superconducting. That means it has no electrical resistance whatsoever. The temperature at which aluminum becomes superconducting is 1.2 degrees Kelvin. That is negative 272 degrees Celsius. That is colder than liquid helium. We can do it using things called dilution refrigerators. We're not going to be able to do what MacGyver does, which is put it in a thermos. Disintegration's a bit dramatic. When we take them out of the fridge, they don't suddenly disintegrate. We can't use them for quantum computation. They do what we call, decoherence. But you know, we can just cool it back down and it's fine. Usually, if we do it slowly enough. Not a next generation style. It's not going to replace your desktops, like I said. And also, just this whole thing, it looks like it's stored in a museum, not a lab. I've seen quantum computing labs. They are messes of wires. They put this in the same lab as like the weird like bio cockroach lab, which is against every sense of like lab safety I've ever seen in my entire life. Come on, this is like supposed to be some sort of like deep government lab. They have funding. They can afford multiple lab spaces. All right. So I'm going to give MacGyver a D plus. It's 2020. We're not allowed to give Fs anymore. All right, one last one trying to explain what quantum computing is.
Normal computers work at either there's power going through a wire or not. One or a zero. They're binary systems. What quantum states allow for is much more complex information to be encoded into a single bit. Regular computer bit is either a one or a zero, on or off. A quantum state can be much more complex than that because, as we know, things can be both particle and wave at the same time, and the uncertainty around quantum states allows us to encode more information into a much smaller computer. So that's what's exciting about quantum computing, and that's what we're talking about.
So this is from a few years, like 2015 or 2016, I honestly forget. I was in the room for that. It was really fun. So that was actually taken in Waterloo at the Perimeter Institute. Someone asked him a question about traffic congestion. And at the beginning of it said, I could ask you about quantum computing, but instead, here's this really relevant problem that everyone wants to know about when the hell there's going to be a train between Waterloo and Toronto. And he responded with a 60-second thing about quantum computing, and I still want to know about this train. But okay, what is he actually saying here? So, superposition states are essential. He's right about that. In order to make quantum computing work, we can't just have zeros and ones. We need to also process things in superposition and measure them in superposition. Qubits are difficult to classically simulate. So a qubit is a quantum bit. The same way a bit can be zero or one, a quantum bit can be zero, one, or superposition of zero and one. The fact that they're difficult to classically simulate, so simulate them on a supercomputer, is actually part of where they get their power from. One of the main reasons to build a quantum computer is to simulate other quantum systems, which might sound like, okay, who cares? Why would we be building it to simulate itself? We're building it to simulate other more difficult to build kinds of quantum systems, things like atoms, molecules. If we want to understand how proteins fold, we better understand the quantum mechanics of it all. If we want to understand high energy physics problems, we better understand the quantum physics of it all. Classical computers are really bad at simulating quantum physics. Quantum computers, when large enough, will be much better able to simulate other quantum problems. Smaller computers, well, you know, if we see pictures of them, they're actually rather large just to get a few quantum bits. And what he gets wrong is, yeah, there's still one bit per qubit. It's a lot of information in one qubit, but when I measure it, just like the slacks either give me casual or formal, I'm only get a zero or a one. I never get both a zero and one at the same time. And it kind of devolves into a little bit of a quantum word search at times. That being said, good on him. Trudeau gets a B+. All right, so as mentioned, okay, so quantum is old tech, but what's actually coming next? Well, scientists are getting better and better at building quantum computers that can be useful for real problems. We're starting to simulate small quantum systems. Google recently announced that they are really the first to claim a quantum advantage, a problem where they use their quantum computer to solve something that a classical computer would take a longer amount of time to solve. Not a particularly useful problem, more of like a test problem just to show that it can in principle work. But as of right now, compared to who's vetted it so far, it has worked. We're still a long ways away from doing like kind of the things that scientists dream about doing with quantum computers. But you know, there's been a lot of progress in the last 20 years. This field only really dates back to the mid-1990s. So the fact that it's advanced that much in the last 25 years is impressive. And even if you're thinking, okay, well, quantum computers can't be the whole thing. Like, we don't want to spend all this money on a quantum computer when, you know, we might run into a roadblock that's just going to make it not work. As we develop these technologies, we're also developing new side technologies that will provide real benefits. Think about the MRI example. That's where we're imaging ourselves with a quantum property of our body. As we get better at controlling quantum systems, we get better at building systems like that that can be used in medical imaging, in geological exploration, and building new kinds of materials. Things that, you know, better quantum sensors, basically. Things that sense the environment around us using quantum properties. So just because we're already using quantum doesn't mean that there's nowhere left to go. There's still a lot left to explore, both in terms of computation, in terms of sensors, in terms of materials, in terms of communications, and in terms of just understanding the world around us. And I look forward to giving this talk again in 20 years and seeing what's on TV then. Thank you so much for your time. Absolutely.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, John.
Hey, Jesse. Hey.
I got a question from earlier with measuring the states of an electron for particle. You said that you shine a light at it to change it, and you shine a light at it to measure it.
Yeah.
What is the difference between those two lights? Is it duration, wavelength?
Duration's part of it. The biggest thing is color. So I drew that as the electron having like an inner orbital and an outer orbital, but the electron actually has many, many other orbitals as well. So, and if I shine a different wavelength of light at it, it might be on-tuned or resonance in quantum language to jump to an even higher level. But if it's in the inner orbital, it just won't be the right color to allow that jump. So we'll see if the electron jumps to an even higher level and then see what light comes out of it then, and that'll determine if it was in the lower energy or the higher energy. So yeah, different wavelength, different durations do play a role, different shapes do play a role, but wavelength is usually the overriding factor. Yeah. Not wrong.
Thank you for the presentation, and especially thank you for all the film clips. Those were great. I should start off by saying I have no scientific training whatsoever. My last bit of scientific education was in high school, so I apologize in advance if the question I'm about to ask makes no sense.
But
there are two things that I have, in a universe of a subject that makes no sense to most people, including myself, there are two things I've always been baffled about. One is that if quantum mechanics is supposed to be the science of the very small, as distinct from things that are very large. Mm-hmm. Is there a border at which quantum effects like superposition cease to exist, or is there in some meaningful way superposition in the macroscopic world? And the other question is, when you say that it is through an observation that things like the probability wave collapses, what does that actually mean? Mm-hmm. Because what from that perspective is an observation, given that particles and matter, things are always interacting with the universe around them. They're always interacting with fields and matter. What is the essence of an observation that causes the probability wave to collapse, whereas other interactions do not?
All right, so I'm gonna go with the observation one first. If I forget to come back to the macroscopic one, yell at me, because that's also a good question. But the observation one is one of the most common questions that comes up, and it's a good one. So we say that when we observe a quantum state, we collapse it, it goes to one possibility or the other. So let's talk about what we actually do when we measure a quantum state. So what I have is I have, let's say that my quantum state is encoded in the magnetic spin of something. So whether or not it has a magnetic field going this way or going this way. To measure that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a probe up next to it, and that probe is going to go one way or the other depending on what the magnetic field was. Now what I'm going to do is that probe is designed in such a way that it sends an electrical signal to my computer, which tells me, was it going this way or this way? Now I'm going to read my computer, I'm going to look at my data, and I'm going to see, was the spin either this way or this way? So the question is, when does it collapse? Is it when it gets close enough to that probe that it sends a signal, that it changes the state of that probe? Is it when that probe sends that electric signal to my computer? Is it when my computer actually reads that as data? Is it when I physically, as a human being, look at that data? It's a bit of an unanswered question, honestly. So there's two main ways to think about it. One is kind of the collapse theory, or as it's sometimes called, shut up and calculate, which is basically, I mean, we know that's what it goes. When I look at my data, I see a zero or a one, an up or a down. So, I mean, it collapsed somewhere in the middle there, but who cares? We get the data that we get, we can do the simulations that we want with that. The other theory is the many worlds theory. Well, there's a couple other ones that I'm kind of brushing under the rug, but let's ignore them for now, keep it simple to the two theories. Many worlds theory states that the spin, when it interacts with the probe, it becomes entangled with the probe. So now, instead of having the state where it's up or down, we have the state where if the spin is up, the probe is up. If the spin is down, the probe is down. They're now correlated. Now, that probe's gonna send an electronic signal to my computer. The electronic signal that it sends is also gonna be quantum correlated to the state of that probe. Now, it's gonna send to my computer. That's gonna tell you that it's either a zero or a one. My computer is now entangled with the spin, with the probe, and with the electronic signal. Now, I read the computer. My brain has a quantum state because at some point, I am made of electrons and atoms and all that kind of stuff. So when I read that computer, now I am entangled with the magnet and with the probe and with the electronic signal and with the computer and with everything else I've interacted with throughout that day. So that's the idea where nothing ever collapses. We just get this larger and larger and larger entangled system that describes the whole universe. Practically, they give the exact same results. If I'm looking at this to like build a laser or build something quantum mechanically, it doesn't matter which one's correct. I'm going to get the same answers either way. Philosophically, though, there's obviously a huge difference. What I think of, like what I use like in my research, what I like kind of think about it that way, I think about it when I stop treating it quantum mechanically when it becomes something macroscopic. So in my case, I would say practically, it's probably when it gets converted to electronic signal. Because you can do experiments, like by bringing in another probe, that show that the probe and the spin are actually entangled after you make that measurement, if you don't actually look at the electronic signal that comes out, or if you don't ask for an electronic signal to come out. But yeah, so it's short answer is it's complicated. And there's a couple different competing theories on when that process actually happens. One of the things that people are looking to do using that kind of process is exactly related to your first question. So that electronic signal is something I would consider macroscopic. It's large. It's something that I can read with, you know, a voltmeter or something that I would consider a very classical piece of technology, a very old piece of technology, something that I can maybe even see with my bare eye if it gets converted to, say, a light signal instead of an electronic signal. People are trying to find ways to push the limits of quantum mechanics into the point where we can like see superposition states of large things that are large enough that we could start considering seeing with our eyes in two different ways. One is making them just larger and larger and larger, seeing interference between different molecules, for example. So we think about molecules as particles, but in quantum physics, they can behave like waves, and we can see interference. And we have these like very large molecules, like not this large, but like, you know, like hundreds of atom-sized molecules, we can see interference. So quantum mechanics still works on that scale. Alternatively, we can push the limits of what we can sense as humans. So there is some evidence out there that humans are actually able to sense single photons. Like our eye, in a completely dark environment, can sense things down to at least the 10-photon level. So can we create entanglement among 10 photons, and can we see that with our eye? What does that even look like? People are working on things like that, and as well as generating states of just like bright light that is entangled or in a genuine superposition state. Eventually, things just start decohering. Things start interacting too much with the environment around them when they become that large, and we stop being able to definitively see things like entanglement and superposition. But trying to push that boundary is what a lot of scientists are working on. Yeah?
So about 20 years ago, there was a lot of hype about nanotechnology.
Yeah, and still
got,
is.
And we got quantum dots, and we got all kinds of material, real stuff that existed in the world. And a similar $10 billion were invested in Japan, and $100 million were invested in all over the place. So there's a lot of money put in, mm-hmm. and it's not clear precisely where that money went.
Fair.
What is the big push for investing, for China investing $100 billion in quantum whatever? Or is it just to, a neurotic worry that they don't want to be left behind? I mean, why does this research have to be state dependent? Mm-hmm. Nation-state dependent.
Why does that have to be nation? Okay, so yeah. So why are we pushing for this, and why does it have to be nation-state dependent? Part of it is because someone at some point made it look like a defense concern, which is not completely invalid. Quantum computers are good at solving problems that could be used to crack codes. That's a thing. It would take a quantum computer of an insane size, but it's technically possible. It's something that no expert in their right mind would say is coming in the next 30 years. But, you know, it is possible. So because of that and because of some other quantum communication protocols, they've been able to sell it to defense contractors. When it becomes a defense thing, then it becomes very national, which I have issues with. That being said, from a scientist level, it's still very internationally collaborative. Aside from people who are like locked under NDAs by defense contractors or by private industry, scientists talk to each other. Doesn't matter where the funding is coming from. They're collaborating with each other. Their conferences are international. Their groups are international. It's not sequestered nation by nation on a practical level in the academic sense. In terms of what we hope to get out of it, why we're investing this much money into it, well, partially, yeah, it's because no one wants to be left behind. You want to develop people who are capable of generating these kinds of technologies, who have these kind of skills. A big part of it is training the next generation of scientists so that they're, you know, fluent in like quantum language. If we want to develop new kinds of technologies, we're going to do that by looking very big and looking very small, looking where we haven't been able to look before. Quantum is one of those realms, and that's for building not just computers, but sensors, materials. So the nanotechnology aspect, that's the one thing where I'm very nervous about how much we push the quantum computing angle, honestly. Because if we go 20 years from now, even if we build the quantum computer and we're using it for useful things, There's going to be some people that are just like, I don't have a quantum computer in my home. Why can't I get a quantum computer from Best Buy? This whole thing must have been a waste of an investment. First off, no one is actually saying you'll ever be able to buy a quantum computer at Best Buy. No one's saying that's what they're meant for at all. But, you know, it makes it seem like anything less than that is a failure. Even if quantum computing doesn't reach the heights as quickly as, you know, some experts expect it to, we're still building other technologies along the way. So we're getting better and better at controlling individual quantum systems. We're getting better and better at using that to build new kinds of materials, new kinds of superconductors, new kinds of sensors, you know, things like that. Nanotechnology bubble, I don't know a whole ton about the nanotechnology bubble of the 80s, but even though it, like, you know, never made, you know, it's hard to look at one thing and say, like, that's where that came from. There's lots of things around that, you know, in some way or another, after a very, very long path, came from that kind of investment. A lot of the, you know, the current tech and current microprocessors, for example, came out of investing a lot of money into research and nanotechnology.
A lot of money was wasted.
Oh, yeah, sure, of course. That's the point of research. Research always wastes money. You never want to do research where someone says, I have this, it's going to work exactly on this time scale. If you're investing in research, there's always going to be failures. There's always going to be unexpected results. And that's part of the process. Not everything I was working on or everything that my friends are working on or anything that anyone I know is working on is like with the mind of like, we're going to build a product. We want to understand the universe. We want to try new kinds of things. And that in itself is a benefit. That in of itself gives unexpected results. So I'm all for exploratory research that doesn't have a definitive goal in mind, because that's where you get things like quantum physics, which was not intended to, you know, solve a problem or build the laser or build the MRI. It came up because someone was like, I don't get it, and studied it for a bit.
I know that there are more questions out there. However, it is 3:30, so despite what the clock says, it's a quantum clock. It's locked. but I know that John would be anxious to answer more questions if you'd like to speak with him. However, before we get to that, I would just like to say thank you very much for coming down with your always entertaining talk. That's fantastic. Will you join me in thanking John? Like I said, I'm sure there are many of you who would like to speak with John. We do have coffee and cookies outside, though, so I'm not sure which is more important to you. But that doesn't mean that we can't superimpose them and have you do both. So I will bring John outside to the lobby and get him some coffee and cookies. Yeah? So we'll do that, and you can bring your questions out there. Thanks very much, and we'll see you at an event soon.